Dull, idiotic, simple. That's not only how I describe myself, but also how scientists in the 20th century were describing DNA. DNA is the chemical that encodes all genetic information and is passed from parent to child. But this hasn't always been known. While scientists knew of DNA as far back as 1869, it took a further 75 years to work out its significance. This massive delay in discovering the chemicals that make up the code of life has been called a scientific catastrophe and a detriment done to the advancement of biological thinking. So this is the story of how that catastrophe happened, and how it was eventually solved with the birth of molecular genetics. By the early 1900s, scientists knew very little about DNA. We only knew the elemental makeup, with maybe some phosphoric acid and some nitrogen substances. But in comes Russian doctor Phoebus Levene, who managed to almost work out the entire primary structure of DNA. He correctly found that DNA is made of three components: a sugar, deoxyribose, a base, A, C, G, or T, and phosphate, into what he called a nucleotide. The phosphate and sugar formed a consistent backbone, while the base changed. But he only had half the picture. We now know that there is a complementary partner to DNA. They first started dating about 3.7 billion years ago. For every A on one strand, we have a T on the other, and for every G, we have a C on the opposite side. But Levene didn't know this. He thought that DNA was just one strand. So when he tried breaking apart DNA to work out how much of each base there was, and got roughly the same amount, he assumed that each base was in equal proportion. This is where Levene comes up with the villain for our story, the Tetranucleotide Hypothesis. It suggests DNA is just repeats of the same four bases over and over again. TAGC, TAGC. Under this hypothesis, every piece of DNA was exactly the same. Without variation, DNA can't carry any information, and so couldn't be the hereditary molecule. The Tetranucleotide Hypothesis remained dominant for over 30 years, shaping the understanding of DNA as this simple molecule that couldn't possibly code for life. And this is where the hero of our story comes in, Erwin Chargaff. In the 1940s, Chargaff got interested in DNA by reading about experiments showing that DNA was transforming bacteria, implying it was carrying information. So, he decided to revisit the science of DNA. Since the work done by Levene several decades prior, chemistry had come a long way, and Chargaff had a bunch of new toys for better and more accurate results than Levene ever did. So, what was Chargaff and his team's process in working out how much of each base is in DNA? They started by extracting DNA from cows and breaking it apart using sulfuric acid. This cuts the bases from their sugar phosphate backbone. By turning them first into crystals, the bigger A and G could be separated from the smaller C and T. They could then separate the bases using paper chromatography, the fancy word for separating molecules based on how much they like to travel with a liquid. For example, C prefers to travel further than T, as it shares similar chemical properties to the liquid being used rather than the paper. They could then cut out different parts of the paper to obtain each individual base. As the final step, they use a UV vis spectrometer to work out how much of each base they had separated out. It works by shining a light on the molecule and measuring the amount of light that's absorbed. The more molecules there are, the more absorbance. This was the technology invented only a couple years before Chargaff's work, so Levene could have never used it. So, what were the results? How much of each base was there? Well, 30% A, 28% T, 19% C, and 24% G. This is very different to the results expected under the Tetranucleotide Hypothesis, where each base should be about 25%. These results showed that the hypothesis that had shaped our understanding of DNA for over 30 years was seemingly disproven, giving good chemical evidence for the complexity of DNA. The implications of this cannot be understated. Refining his methods, Chargaff would later discover that A and T and G and C were always in equal amounts. Watson and Crick would later use this as a key piece of evidence in arguing for their infamous proposal for the double helix structure of DNA. Only a year later, the Hershey and Chase experiment finally confirmed that it was DNA that was encoding for genetic information. Within only a few short years, DNA went from this boring string of repetitive bases to this gorgeously complex double helix structure that could encode for life. Once scientists understood DNA better, the next step was to start learning to read it. But that is a story for another.